Okay. Good morning and welcome to the 29th meeting of the Education, Children and Young People Committee in 2022. We have apologies from Stephen Kerr, so can we put those on the record, please? The first item on our agenda today is the third evidence session on the National Care Service Scotland Bill, and we will hear from Claire Haughey, the Minister for Children and Young People, Kevin Stewart, the Minister for Wellbeing and Social Care, Paul Beaton, Children's Services, the Unit Head, Iona Colvin, Chief Social Work Advisor, and Donna Bell, the Director of Social Care and National Care Service Development. Good morning. The Ministers will each give a short opening statement, and can I start with Mr Stewart, please, followed by Ms Haughey. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to you and to the committee, and many thanks for having Ms Haughey and myself here today. I'll give an overview of our approach to the bill. Ms Haughey will focus on services for children and young people in the context of the National Care Service. And I should say at the outset that no decision has been taken on transferring children's services or criminal justice to the National Care Service. It's fair to say that the National Care Service is one of the most ambitious reforms of public services, which will end the postcode lottery of care provisions across Scotland. It will ensure access to consistent, high-quality care and support, enabling people to live a full life. The NCS Bill sets out the framework for the changes we want to make and allows scope for further decisions to be made later through a co-design process. This flexibility enables the National Care Service to develop, adapt and respond to specific circumstances over time. I want to take time to reflect on why change of this scale is necessary. Scotland's community health and social care system has seen significant incremental change over the last 20 years. Despite this, people with experience of receiving care support and providing it have been clear that there are some significant issues. We are not just changing to address the challenges of today. We must ensure that we build a public service fit for tomorrow. Today, about 1 in 25 people receive social care, social work and occupational health support in Scotland. Demand is forecast to grow, and the NCS must be developed to take account of our future needs. And we'll build a system that is sustainable and future-proofed to take account of the changing needs of our population. The principles of any new system will be person-centred. This means that the NCS will be delivered in a way that respects, protects and fulfils the human rights of people accessing and delivering care and support. I was at Turning Point Scotland in Perth on Monday to hear about their excellent work supporting people with complex needs, including preventative work with school leavers to turn their lives around. Their work highlights the value of focusing on the whole person and collaborating across boundaries. Our co-design process will ensure that the NCS is built with the people that it serves and those that deliver it at its very heart. And we are committed to working with people with first-hand experience of accessing and delivering community health and social care to ensure that we have a person-centred NCS. We have to have a care service that is person-centred, that best fits the needs of people who will use and work in its services. Thank you very much, Convener.
Thank you, Minister.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Committee, and thank you for your invitation today. Mr Stewart has spoken about what we hope to achieve with this reform of Scotland's community health and social care system, and I would now like to speak about the impact the National Care Service will have on services for children and young people. The National Care Service will provide support for adults, children's parents, their grandparents, their adult siblings. And the most important structure around children is their family, and services need to wrap around the family. Children become adults and transition between services, which is often a difficult process. The current landscape is complex, with 31 integration authorities taking a variety of approaches to the integration of children's services with adult, community health and justice services. We have to ask ourselves, is the best way to help children for these services to be together or apart? To answer this question, we've commissioned independent research to consider how children's services are currently delivered across Scotland. No change is not an option, so it would be too risky not to consider including children's services now. However, I want to reiterate Mr Stewart's point that no decision has been made about whether children's services will be included in the National Care Service or not. The Bill therefore provides the mechanism to include children's services in the NCS by secondary legislation if we ultimately decide that's what's best for children, young people and families. The full detail of any proposal to include children's services in the NCS will be available for scrutiny, consideration and consultation. The Independent Care Review told us that significant change is needed to improve the care and support that children and young people receive. And all of us here and across all the organisations that work with children and families are committed to delivering the promise. Building on this approach to getting it right for every child, we are continuing to make improvements we need to see in children's services, and this work will not pause because of the National Care Service. Strong links with other services that support children, education, early learning and childcare must be maintained and strengthened whatever the decision is. I also recognise the challenges and demands those working with children and families face every day. If we were to transfer children's services to the National Care Service, it must improve the experience of the workforce. We want to carefully consider whether it would be best to include services which support children and young people in the National Care Service. Meanwhile, we will make sure that the needs of children and young people are a key consideration in the development of the National Care Service. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you both for your opening statements. Can I ask a first question? Over the past two committees sessions, we've heard from various stakeholders, and quite an extensive list as well, and no one is looking for or demanding children's services to be included in the National Care Service. Most were ambivalent at best, and they were overwhelmingly concerned that this was an absolute giant distraction that would get in the way of them doing their work. So can you honestly say that this will not be a bureaucratic monster that will get in the way of children's services providing the care that's needed? And why are those on the front line so not convinced that this is the right approach to be taking? Mr Stewart first, please.
Convener, I think that the committee can be well assured that this will not become a bureaucratic nightmare. This is about improving services for people right across the country. As we have said already, we are doing the groundwork, as Ms Hawkey has outlined, to look at whether it is right to include children's services in National Care Service. And I know that some people are not in favour of this change. However, what can be said is that the voices of lived experience have highlighted to us over the course of the discussions that we've had over the past 18 months around about some of the difficulties that they experience in terms of accessing care and support. And one of the key things for people is transition phases, for example. The movement from children's services to adult services is not smooth for a lot of people in our country at this moment. In some parts of the country, these scenarios are much better than others. Again, if you talk to the voices of lived experience, they will make it quite clear some of their views around about where it works best. And where it does work best, and this is my opinion here, is in those areas where greater integration has occurred, where the scenario is that IJBs have delegation of various things, including children's social work, social care services, and children's health services. And, you know, that, without doubt, I would say, is the view of many folks. We are lucky enough to have Iona Colvin as our chief social worker, but before she came to work in government, she's had a vast range of experience in life, but she was a chief officer in North Ayrshire Health and Social Care Partnership, where there is a greater degree of integration. It may be an idea, convener, to hear from Ms Colvin around about her previous experiences in that.
Oh, thank you. Thanks very much. Thanks, Mr Stewart. So I think the first thing to say is that the current status quo is not going to be an option if we're going to have a national care service with adult services in it. So that was one of the first considerations in thinking about what the options are really for children's services. And as the ministers have said, the decision's not been made yet. Time has been spent looking at it. We then looked at, then been thinking about, I mean, for me, one of the key factors is the relationship to the adult care services. Children don't come into the care system mostly because of actions of themselves. It's mainly because of their parents or their families. And usually it's because of drug or alcohol misuse or mental health problems, or sometimes disproportionately people with learning disability as well, parents with learning disability. So there's a real core connection for me in terms of the family support element. So in North Ayrshire, basically, we had agreed, the elected members and the health board had agreed to delegate all of the children's services into the partnership. We also had an arrangement where we delegated mental health services for children in as well, where I was the director of mental health for Ayrshire and as well as the director of health and social care in North Ayrshire. And what that meant, and they carry it on now, North Ayrshire are doing tremendously interesting stuff, was we were able to pool resources to begin to look at how we develop seamless services around children and young people. And mental health is a classic where there was really a divergence between health services and social work, for example, and the third sector are really important. But what it allowed us to do was to begin to look at how you began to join those services up around children, but also how we take a family focus in the adult side of services as well. And I think that's really the really important point here is when children are at risk of being taken into care, because this is not just about when they come into care, most of this is about how do we prevent them coming to a point of coming into care. So I think being able to bring together your health and your social work services for children allows you to look at opportunities to work upstream as well. Working in the schools, for example, to support the teachers and to support a kind of whole school approach around children, and working in the nurseries. And North Ayrshire also have a really good integrated universal team, which is using the health visiting service to push out multidisciplinary services. So in their health visiting service, they have infant mental health nurse, they have a CAMHS nurse, they have social workers, so that they can push through at an earlier stage that kind of support. And I think that's the opportunities that are afforded here. And I would say that the Health and Social Care Partnership there, and in my experience, also manages to work, even though it's all those services managed within health and social care, they're working in schools, they're working in the nurseries. And I think that's one of the opportunities.
I think, convener, as well, and I'm sure the committee has some of this information already, but, you know, we can provide more of it. There are 31 integration authorities in Scotland at the moment. Some operate with fully delegated powers for community children's health services, children's social care services, and justice social work services. We can provide a breakdown to the committee of where these things are currently happening, where those delegations are complete.
We have that, Minister. Yes, I think we had that. Yeah, okay. Thank you. But thank you very much for, I think the answer from Ms Colvin there does explain some. I know we'll pick on that thread later on with questionings from Mr Mara. But I suppose everyone that's come to committee that's presented evidence has always said to us, I think, is that structural change is not the answer. I think we had Ross McGuffey from North Lanarkshire tell the committee last week that transformative change takes time, and sometimes we end up reaching the next restructure before the current one has had the chance to be where it needs to be. And I know how complex IGB and that legislation is. So, yes, I recognise that that is perhaps not the answer. We need to do something. But would it not be better to improve the current system that is currently taking place and take our time investing in that rather than perhaps going through the magnitude? And that's where my concern is in terms of that huge structural change, getting managers in place rather than really focusing on those that are in there working with our children and families delivering services.
Convener, the reason why we have embarked on this journey of National Care Service is not because it is a whim of the government. It comes from the Derek Feely report in terms of the independent review of adult care, which highlighted a number of things and made a huge number of recommendations, including the formation of a National Care Service. And during our discussions with stakeholders, with the voices of lived experience and others, before we went to consultation, people were telling us that this should encompass more. Now, I think we have been very careful in the way that we have done this. So the consultation showed that over 70% of folk wanted to see a National Care Service. Many of those folks wanted to see the transfer of services like children's services and criminal justice and social work into the National Care Service. We didn't fully go ahead with all of that. That's why we're doing all of the work that we're doing in ensuring that we get this absolutely right. Because whether something is in or out, we have to make sure that the linkages are right. There are a number of things which folk highlighted to us. One of the main ones was accountability. People felt that there was no accountability in many cases in their areas. And, lots of folk highlighted the fact that often they're pushed from pillar to post when they're told that's the responsibility of the Health and Social Care Partnership, that's the responsibility of local government, that's the responsibility of the Health Board. And that is frustrating for people when they are trying to get the care and support that they need. The other key element of this was folk wanted to see national accountability. And that national accountability means that ministers can set national high-quality standards which will apply across the board and end the postcode lottery. That doesn't mean to say that it is a centralisation, because local care boards will continue to shape and deliver services in their own locales, but obviously we'll have to abide by those national standards. So I think the accountability aspect is one of the things which is way up the agenda of people. And why is it way up the agenda? Because of the implementation gaps that there currently are in the system. And I talked in my opening remarks around about the 20-year journey of integration. And there has been change, and there has been change for the better. But there are still a lot of implementation gaps. And why is that the case? Because we have not involved people enough in shaping these services. And we are all about ensuring that as we move forward, this is co-designed with people in order for us to get it right, to close those implementation gaps and to deliver better services for people.
I think we'll find today that we might jump around a bit in some of those, in terms of some of the statements you've just made there. I know there's questions on that, those comments later on. So hopefully we can all keep track of that. But can I go to Mr. Day, who's got a follow-up of mine before we go to Mr. Rennie?
Thanks. Many thanks, Convener. You talked about addressing the postcode lottery, Mr. Stewart, and getting a service fit for tomorrow. We would all want that. But you've also talked there about the implementation gaps. And in the evidence that the committee has taken so far from some of the professionals, there was an underlying admission on their part, certainly that I took from it, which was that this is a sector that, in part, is resistant to change and has been resistant to change for some time. We see that with the IJBs and the variation and the extent to which services are delivered locally. So given that, what makes you confident that the National Care Service, with all its laudable aims, will deliver what you want it to, given that you will have people on the ground charged with delivering this who may well be culturally resistant to change in general and this specific change?
I recognise that legislation and regulation does not necessarily change cultures, and you know, we've got examples of that in terms of some of the very good pieces of legislation which have been before this Parliament before. Probably the best example I can give is self-directed support, whereby we put forward on a cross-party basis, it was agreed, the ability for folk to have more independence and autonomy in terms of their care, with four different options that people could access which best suited their needs. And we know that in some parts of the country that works immensely well, and in others it doesn't, because rather than stick with the spirit of the legislation, and some people in some places people have looked for the flaws within the legislation and found them and given reasons why certain things shouldn't apply to certain folks. And that's not good enough, to be honest. And, you know, we're about to publish new guidance around about self-directed support. It will help with some of those difficulties that people face. But, you know, there's still the edginess to the primary legislation. So one of the reasons why we're embarking on this co-design journey is to have all people, those voices of lived experience and stakeholders, to shape how we move forward in this. And beyond that, by bringing some of the elements into secondary legislation, it means that we can change quite quickly if we find those flaws, which we've been unable to do in terms of self-directed support because it is enshrined in primary legislation. So there's a greater flexibility there. In terms of the cultural aspect, I think there are a number of things. That flexibility will help change cultures. But beyond that, you know, having the voices of lived experience at the heart of what we're doing. Now, you know, people have asked me, who do you see being on care boards? And obviously there are folks who are going to have to be there. But I've tried to keep stream on that because that's a matter for the co-design as well. But the one thing that I am absolutely adamant on is that the voices of lived experience must be on local care boards and must have votes. And that will help us change the cultures too, I would imagine it will happen.
You could also have cited the Carers Act as another example where local delivery hasn't lived up to the expectation of the legislation. And as I read it, This proposal has a potential to help address that and give carers a better deal.
Absolutely. I mean, I was at the Carers Parliament the week before last. And, you know, from the questioning from the floor to the panel, a large amount of that questioning was around about why is it that money that is allocated to my area is not being spent on carers. Now, as folk around the table know, convener, the government has said that it's not going to ring fence large elements of money that it gives to local authorities. And obviously, local authorities make choices. But I think in some regards here, there is a real difficulty for folks who care for people when they cannot access services, when they know that money that is being sent for carers is not going to carers. You know, I think off the top of my head, it's some 84, 85 million where now government is now sending per year to ensure that the Carers Act is lived up to. And if you talk to some folk out there, including a man from Shetland who's at the Carers Parliament, who has FOI'd the information and kind of get it around about what Shetland is doing. You know, I'm checking up on that because that allegation has to be checked up on. But, you know, we have to make sure that that money is actually going to carers. And I think the other element within the bill, and a very important element within the bill, in terms of carers, is enshrining into law that right to short-term breaks. You know, that is absolutely essential.
Thank you.
Thank you. Now, can we move to questions from Willie Rennie, please? Thank you, Willie.
I'm not sure it's correct to brand the senior people that we had before this committee as recalcitrants, as resistant to change. I mean, we had Claire Burns from Celsus. She was talking about concern about unpicking everything. We had Martin Crewe, who's got decades of experience in the Children's Service, and he's saying, I cannot see that the NCS would have a big positive impact. Jackie Irvin from the Care Inspectorate talking about disruption. So I'm not sure it's right to just dismiss them as resistant to change. But my main question is about the fact that Children's Services were clearly an afterthought. Why were they not included in the Feely report? And why haven't you still yet, even though you're going through the process of legislation, decided whether it's included or not?
Convener, sorry, you want to go first?
No, that's all right. Sorry. I'll come in for the second
Convener, first of all, I've not talked about anybody being resistant to change this morning. I just want to put that on the record. Although, sometimes we have to take folk on a journey around about seeing the benefits of the change that we embark on. And to answer Mr. Rennie, the government in the previous term, Jean Freeman, asked Derek Feely to look at adult social care, and that independent review took place. And I'm not going to go through all of the elements of that, because I'm quite sure the committee is very well aware of the recommendations that Mr. Feely made. And after that, we as a government went and talked to the voices of lived experience around about the recommendations. That includes folks from the likes of the Social Covenant Steering Group who have real experience of where service works and where it doesn't for them. And what became very apparent from those discussions, and not only with the voices of lived experience, but with stakeholders too, is that folks thought that there could be and should be a widening out of this, and that we should look at that. And that's why we included questions in our consultation to look at whether or not there was an appetite for moving beyond adult social care. And there has been an appetite in terms of the responses that we have had. However, you asked a pertinent question around about the work that we're doing, not only just in children's services, but also in criminal justice and other areas. If we are going to do this, we have to have the evidence and the reasoning for doing it. And that's why we are carrying out the review work at this moment, which I'm sure Ms. Hawkey will tell us much more about.
Thank you, Mr. Stewart. So, following on from what my colleague's saying there, so the independent review into adult social care made recommendations which we see are equally applicable to children's services. So having fairness and equity, removal of variation in eligibility and charging and commissioning, and removing unwanted variation across services, local authorities and IJBs. And given the change that the National Care Service Bill, if it's passed, would bring, it would be too risky not to consider the inclusion of children in the National Care Service. None of us would want to think of children as an afterthought. The interface between the services for adults and children has been a critical consideration in considering the impact that the NCS could have on children's services. And Mr. Stewart and as Iona Colvin mentioned in their evidence, that you cannot see children in isolation. Children live as part of families and they don't live in silos. Their needs are not singular. So we are looking at this in the round. The public consultation that Mr. Stewart also mentioned in 2021 included questions on children's social work and children's social care services. The responses to that were mixed, and key stakeholders highlighted that there would be the need for more evidence, and that's what we have set out to do.
But you're not looking at it as a whole system, are you? You've decided already that you're creating a national care service that will have ramifications for children's services. So you're not looking at in the round. You've decided you're going to take one part out of the system, and then you're going to decide, as an afterthought, what children's services are going to do in response to that disruption. So you're not looking at things in the round. I mean, you've talked an awful lot this morning about co-design. So if the co-design process, which is presumably going to include the recipients of the services as well as those who provide them, if they decide that it would actually be better to leave things as they are in terms of structure, are you going to undo all this?
We're going to have a national care service to deal with adult social care.
That was a
recommendation from Feely. That's what the voices of lived experience want. That is what many stakeholders want. And we are going to look at, as we've explained this morning, whether or not to include other elements, including children's services and criminal justice services. And if, as part of that co-design, folks say, well, you know, this elements may not work, then we have to be cognizant of that, because we're not going to be dismissive of folk in the sector or of the voices of lived experience. But no matter, as I said earlier, what is out or what is in National Care Service, we have to make sure that the linkages are there between NCS and the services that remain out with NCS. And I think, you know, convener, one of the things is today, the concentration will be, should this be out? On Thursday, you know, there were folks at the Social Justice Committee who were saying, you know, housing and homelessness services should maybe be in. Now,
this makes my point for me. You're making this up as you go along.
Not at all.
You are deciding already you're going to have a big disruption with a new law to create a national care service without even deciding what's going to be in the national care service. That's making it up as you go along.
Convener, the government stood in a manifesto of creating a national care service to cover adult social care. What we have done since then is have listened to people who have said that we should make other considerations as well, which we are looking at, which we included in questions in terms of the consultation. And we are carrying out, as the committee is well aware, work to look and review all of that suggestions. Now, no matter what, and I cannot reiterate this enough, no matter what is out or in National Care Service, we have to ensure the linkages are there. And this work is valuable work, no matter what, in order to get it right in terms of the delivery for people. And at the heart of getting it right for delivery for people, people should be at the heart of co-designing that with us.
Well, that's clearly not the case. But can you tell me, how much will it cost, additional cost be, for restructuring this to include children's services? What will be the cost of including children's services?
Well, the financial memorandum as it stands includes everything that's covered off by the bill. And what I have said to the Finance Committee,
what the
government has said to the Finance Committee, is that we will bring forward at each stage the business cases for each aspect of delivery as we move forward. That will give Parliament the transparency, the openness to scrutinise all of this as we move forward.
Why can't you give me a figure, Mr Stewart?
Mr Rennie is well aware that in terms of a financial memorandum, that covers the bill, and that is what we have done. And in terms of a figure for particular things, if I were to pluck a figure
I'm asking you just to give me an accurate figure. And why I can't understand. This proves the point that you're making it up as you go along. You don't know how much this will cost.
In terms of the financial memorandum that covers off the aspect of the bill itself, in 2026-7, if we transfer children's services to care boards, from the Financial Memorandum 26-27, 1.5 billion would be that figure there. But we will clarify all of this as we move forward with Parliament. I know that some folk want me to do the annual budgeting for the next umpteen years around about this, which Mr Swinney would not be particularly happy with if I were to do so. And we have said to the Finance Committee that as we move forward beyond the Financial Memorandum and what it has in the Financial Memorandum, we will bring forward every business case for scrutiny.
Yeah, the Finance Committee, have members of it have criticised you, including members of your own party, for not having the finances. You quoted 1.5 billion. That's not the cost of restructuring to include children's services. That would be the cost, I presume, of the actual children's services themselves. I'm asking, what would be the additional cost of including children's services in the National Care Services structure?
So we have in the Financial Memorandum, Convener, a range of figures around about the restructuring costs, including on page 6 of the Financial Memorandum, which is the total estimated costs of the bill provisions, which give ballpark figures. So for care boards, the 25-26 figure, £132 to £326 million. 26-27, £142 to £376 million. You know, we can spell out more of this financial memorandum to the committee if that's what the committee requires. We can also provide the committee with a comprehensive report, or even we can get officials to come and speak to the committee around about the financial memorandum and the workings of the financial memorandum, much of which I've been questioned about already by the Finance Committee, and the figures are there within that financial memorandum.
If the figures are there, it was your own member, Mr Stewart, from Michelle Thompson, said, I feel as though whether you are under pressure of timescales to deliver on this, from financial scrutiny, I am looking at a blank cheque for the public purse, and I find that deeply worrying. I think that's what we're trying to get over here, is we're in a position right now where there are significant pressures across budgets, and is this the right time to be doing this?
There are significant pressures across budgets, and you know, last week's UK budget did not help in that regard. And
I
that
think,
is why,
Mr Stewart, there's an extra £1.5 billion coming to the Scottish Government.
I would dispute that, Convener, but I think that we probably better not go into
the machinations of that today.
But I would dispute that figure. And beyond that, Convener, as I highlighted earlier, we cannot afford to stand still here in terms of National Care Service. We know that we need to build services that are fit for the future. We have to build services that are sustainable. We have to build services that meet the needs of the changing demographics of our population. That is required. So there can be no standing still. But what I cannot do here today is I cannot give you the annual budgeting for each aspect of service delivery, because that is dealt with on an annual basis. But what I will say to the committee, as I've reiterated to the Finance Committee, is the fact that as we move forward in all of this, we will bring forward all of the financial cases, business cases, for the decisions that we make as we move on.
I think the unknowns here are clearly alarming and should be concerning to us all. Can I move to questions now from Michael Mara, please?
It's just a short one on this area, Convener. How many children's social workers are you proposing to move to the National Care Service, Ms Hawkey?
So, if the decision is made that children's services will be moved to the National Care Service, then those services will move under the National Care Service.
If you're social workers?
I can't give you an exact figure just now.
There are a number of elements here which are important. And I have said previously at the, well, I'm forgetting which committee I've been to now, there need not be a wholesale transfer of staff to National Care Service. I've explained that in terms of social care, and in terms of social work, our ambition is to create a national social work agency. But that may not lead to a huge wholesale transfer of staff either. But we need to work our way through that. What we do definitely need to do in terms of social work is to make sure that no matter what, we look at pay, conditions, and other aspects.
It's not an answer to my question, Mr. Stewart. My question was, how many social workers will be transferred? And I think the answer is you don't know.
So there's no decision being taken in that. That is part of the co-design.
Minister, please. It should be a simple question, I think, but Ms. Hawkey.
So Mr. Stewart, I think, has answered. I can tell you what the overall headcount for children's social services is.
Be useful.
Yeah, okay. So in 2021, the overall headcount for children's social services was 15,300. That's an increase of 6.7 since 2021. And the largest two subsectors in children's social services were in residential care and fieldwork social work. Fieldwork social work accounts for 38% of the total headcount, and that fieldwork social services covers social work services. In 2021, there were 9,100 of the children's social services workforce were employed by a public employer, and not all social workers are employed by public employers. 24% employed by the voluntary sector and 16% employed by private sector. And of course that doesn't necessarily mean that all of those employees are social workers. Some of them are social care workers.
But we don't have an idea at the moment then how many of those people would be transferred to a new body. I think, and I'm not asking about them, just to clarify what you were saying, I think that's the case. I mean, that's what Mr. Stewart just said. We don't know whether they will transfer or not. Just finishing on this, the Scottish Association of Social Workers have asked for a pause on this, as you'll be aware. I mean, they are gravely concerned, I think, about the shape of this, because they don't have the answers to this. Have you taken into the financial memorandum any consideration of pensions, which are not included under TUPE, and what would happen to social workers' pensions?
Sure. Mr. Mara, I think in terms of all of this, we have to look at the National Social Work Agency proposals and come up with a co-design around about this. And I'll bring Ms. Colvin in a minute. And I must make these points, Convener. We have a situation at this moment where there is no single national body tasked with having oversight of leading social workers' professional development, their education, their improvement. And there is disparate pay and conditions across the country, which leads to difficulties in terms of recruitment and retention in many areas. Now, these are issues that have been highlighted by social workers over the piece, and we have to ensure that we get these things right. There's also no mechanism at the moment to secure placements required as part of future social work planning. And as several organisations advocate, deliver and advise in social work education at the moment, it hasn't been possible to scale up best practice. So in order for there to be improvement in all of this, we need to look at change. And establishing a national organisation for that training, development, recruitment and for the retention for adult social care support, including a specific social work agency for the oversight of professional development, is something that a lot of people believe is the right thing to do. Now, I get the point that some of the organisations want a pause, but also I think that if you ask them, they also want to be at the heart of co-designing the elements of a national social work agency and how we get that right as we go forward. And I'll maybe pass over to Ms. Colvin, please, Convener.
The questions from Michael Mara specifically around numbers and finance there, aren't they, Mr. Mara?
Well, they were. If
the answer that come from Ms. Colvin will respond with the specifics that Mr. Mara is looking for, that would be helpful.
Particular reference to social workers' working conditions in terms of pensions and whether that's been factored into the financial calculations. No. Okay.
No. Okay. I think, can we move to questions now from Ross Greer, please? Thank you, Ross.
Thank you, Convener. Ministers, I accept what you said this morning in terms of the current state of play being a postcode lottery across local authorities in terms of the services that are provided to children. But a lot of the evidence that we've taken in recent weeks, particularly from local authorities, made the point that, especially in the areas where children's services are performing well, they are extremely well integrated in the other services that local authorities provide to children, particularly education. How would centralising children's care services to the new bodies, surely that would be a step backwards in terms of our attempts to create a consistent network of support for each individual young person from all the various places in which they might need that, whether it's an education setting, a care setting, or elsewhere?
So we absolutely know that there are some areas of extremely good practice. I think Iona Colvin referenced one in North Ayrshire. Great examples of a shared multidisciplinary culture with a shared goal of improving services for children and for families. We are looking at whether children's services are within a national care service, the opportunities that would give us to scale those up, to have those national standards, to drive that good practice in other areas where perhaps it isn't as good as in some areas that we can cite. And it would give us the opportunity to do that. I think the points that you raise about education and early learning are important ones. And ensuring that those linkages remain strong and that they are built on is absolutely key. That's really important. And of course, all of the government's work with children and young people is underpinned by GIRFIC. So getting it right for every child, and by extension into the care service, getting it right for everyone. So those principles would remain the same, that the care and the support for that child, for that family, should be individualised, should be for their needs, and should be a wrap-round service. And this is the opportunity that we are looking at in children's services being included in the National Care Service, that gives us that opportunity to expand that across the country by having those national standards.
If the decision is made at a later point to include children's services, that will presumably entail a decision, a calculation of how much that's currently spent by local authorities on children's services is moved then to the new delivery bodies. Given what I've just said and the evidence that we've taken about the high level of integration in some authorities between children's care services and other services they provide to children, how will you make that calculation of what to take from what's currently in the local government general revenue grant?
I think there are a number of points there, and I'll come back to the general revenue grant in a second, but I think you make an absolutely excellent point around about those areas where there is a greater degree of integration and where we are seeing very, very good service delivery. Iona Colvin talked about North Ayrshire earlier. Another good example is East Renfrewshire, I would say. We want to absolutely ensure that good service delivery remains, but not only in East Renfrewshire, but that we can export those good services with those right linkages right across the board, right across the country. We have the opportunity to be able to do that as we move on. In terms of the general revenue grant, Mr. Greer was at the Finance Committee and questioned me there around about the impact on local government in terms of budgetary terms, depending on what is in or out. And I would give Mr. Greer the same pledge here as I did at the Finance Committee, which is that we will do our utmost to ensure that there is cost neutrality in all of this for local government as we move forward.
I'm sure local government will welcome that statement. I'm interested in the process by which that will be achieved, though, Minister, because at the heart of my question is this point of how complicated it's going to be, how well integrated these services are in some places, so how difficult it will be to disaggregate them. So I'm interested in what process you'll follow to make that calculation and to ensure that it is cost neutral.
Well, Mr Greer, convener, will be very well aware, again from the committee, that I indicated that all of the work that we are doing at this moment, including this review work, will look at all of that as we move forward. And as we propose and make these changes, we will bring all of the elements of the business cases for that to committees, to Parliament, in order that that can be scrutinised. And I would imagine that a huge amount of other stakeholders will be scrutinising us on that front too. There are, I think, some difficulties in terms of some of those calculations. As the committee is well aware, it is often quite difficult for us to get certain aspects of data. And in all of this too, this creates a good ability to actually improve data collection as we move forward so that we know some of the spend that goes on out there, which we're not quite sure of at this moment. And it goes back to Mr Day's point around about carers. We know, government knows, that it's 84, 85 million, if I remember rightly, and if it's not, I'll correct it, that goes to local authorities to ensure that the Carers Act is there, but we are not absolutely certain that all of that money is spent on that particular service, as Mr Greer and others will know.
Thank you, Minister. It's just we have got a lot of ground to cover, and I'm very aware that we're not making that much progress, and some of, no disrespect, but some of the answers are quite lengthy. So can I ask for some brevity and some concise answers, please, if that's possible. Ross, but if you do have any further questions, please
feel free. I'm happy to finish at that point, Convener.
Okay. Thank you, Ross. Can we now move to questions from Stephanie Callaghan? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Convener. Chapter 3 of the Bill is about creating an NCS Charter, and I'm wondering, will this be a touchstone for the work to develop the NCS, and is the Charter likely to be limited to principles or include rights and responsibilities? And also, you've touched on improving accountability, so I'm interested in how that might work in practice for individuals, and with that in mind, whether ministers should have a duty to ensure advocacy services are available for children and young people with disabilities and additional support needs.
Convener, some of the early work that we are doing in co-design is on the Charter of Rights and Responsibilities. And I was very pleased to be able to attend a virtual event last week or the week before last around about how we build that charter. Facing a fair amount of challenging questions, it has to be said, by many stakeholders about how we get this right. And that's what we need to do. We need to be pretty challenging in all of these regards. We want to make sure that in that co-design that it is inclusive as possible. And we absolutely need to hear from a myriad of voices around about how we get this right, because many people have been failed in the system previously. And, you know, we have already garnered a lot of views, but there are missing voices as well. And we've got to do better in ensuring that they too are at the table in terms of helping us create the charter itself. So you mentioned young people with disabilities, and you know, many disabled folks have been excluded from deciding, helping shape these kinds of things previously. We want them to be at the table. We have had some criticism, and I think it's fair criticism, from some ethnic minority groups that they have been excluded in terms of some of these designs in the past. And again, we're going out of our way to try and get folks from those communities involved too. I'll bring in Iona Iona Colvin for a brief bit, and I'll maybe come back. Convener.
I'm going to interject again, sorry. I was wondering if maybe Ms Haughey might want to respond to that question as well before we go to...
Yeah, thank you. That's fine. So,
So as a minimum, the Charter will set out the rights and responsibilities in relation to the NCS of people accessing support there, information on the complaints and redress system, which will provide recourse if rights in the Charter are not met, and information on how to access information, advice and advocacy services, which I think was one of the points that Ms Callaghan made. So that's as a minimum, but as Mr Stewart's saying, we're consulting, including with children and young people, on exactly what that Charter of Rights should include. But those are the basic minimums.
And I can bring in Iona, but can I just remind the panel that we're focusing on the children's element. We know there's an extensive work going on with the National Care Service across adult services, but we really need to drill down, which is what your questions are on, Stephanie. So if we can pick up your questions, that would be super. Stephanie, carry on.
Yep, that's fine. You've already said today as well about the local care boards continuing to shape those changes at local level. So I'm wondering to what degree do you expect ministers will be responsible for service delivery and directing those care boards? And how will any shift in the powers and responsibilities of local and national government make sure that flexibility to adapt to those local circumstances isn't lost?
Convener, it is absolutely essential that local care boards continue to have the flexibility that is required to deliver for their area. They will have the responsibilities for delivery in their area. They will have the responsibility for shaping services in their area. They will have the flexibility. However, the important element is, of course, that they will have to work to the national high quality standards. That stops postcode lotteries, but it doesn't stop innovation in terms of the ability for local care boards to be as flexible and to meet the needs, meet the needs of the people and the communities that they serve. In terms of ministerial direction, in terms of that accountability element which folk want to see rest with ministers, that in the main is around about the setting of those standards and ensuring that those standards are met across the board in order to meet what we all want, which is the ending of those postcode lotteries that most definitely exist. And sometimes those postcode lotteries exist not only between areas, but also within areas as well. And we need to resolve those elements.
Would you like to comment on?
I think Mr. Stewart's covered all of that there.
Okay, that's fine. Can we now move to some questions from Mr. Bob Doris, please?
Thanks, Convener. I kind of want to use a couple of specific examples because it can appear a bit vague what the National Care Service will look like for children. So giving specific examples, Convener, I think is important. So kinship care is an area I've been campaigning in for a number of years to make sure that children and young people who otherwise would be looked after in a residential setting get the support with family members and loved ones that they require. So there are currently 4,456 young people in formal kinship relationships in Scotland who get kinship care allowances. But those vary dramatically across Scotland, Convener. So, for example, for children between 5 to 10-year-olds, you can get £96 a week or you can get £200 a week or anything in between across 32 local authorities. Is the expectation that that will be standardised under a National Care Service? If so, can you give an assurance that standardisation will be at the higher end and not the bottom end of that scale? And where there's a financial gap in relation to what local authorities are currently putting into that system, who funds that gap?
So I think there would be an opportunity there to address this if Children's Services is transferred into the National Care Service. I am aware of the history behind kinship allowances being different over different areas and different local authorities paying different rates and different allowances within each of their kinship care allowances. Transferred into the National Care Service at a national level with accountability for to ministers, we envisage that NCS setting standards and national frameworks should be implemented at the local level by directly funded care boards. And one of the key aims of the NCS is to end that postcode lottery across a number of areas, as we've spoken about this morning, including consistency in areas where there should be consistency, such as things like financial assistance to kinship carers. So I suppose the short answer to that is yes, we think that this could help in terms of being able to ensure consistency of care allowances right across the piece, rather than, as you say, currently different local authorities pay at different rates, which I appreciate can cause a frustration.
Because COSLA is involved, you'll probably say that will be negotiations between local authorities and the National Care Board about who picks up the tag for that. If you're a local authority paying £100 a week and that is shaped to £200 a week, there's a financial consequence to that. So if you're able to say any more on that, that would be helpful. But also in kinship care, what there also is 32 different authorities. I think the Social Work Scotland said that there's a lack of clarity of what... I know there's clarity in law, Minister, but there's a lack of clarity and criteria for kinship care as to when financial assistance is given. And the example I've given, Convener, consistently this committee is a grandmum takes a child into her home after the death of the child's mum. Quite often kinship care allowance is not granted. But if social work turns up at the door with that child and saying, really sorry, your daughter's been lost, well, you look after the grandchildren, kinship care payments are paid. That's just deeply unfair. And there's 32 ways that's interpreted across Scotland. And at a very local level, different social work service officers may interpret it differently on the ground also. Will this be addressed under the National Care Service? Because this brings, Convener, I'm trying to get a reality of what this will look like on the ground rather than the abstract of a framework bill.
I'm very familiar with the narrative that Mr. Doris gives here. This gives us the opportunity, yes, to get that consistency right across the country. We've worked very closely with kinship carers. We've heard the concerns that they have. And I think this is one area that would give us that opportunity to have the national consistency for carers.
Okay. I wanted to mention palliative care. Does I have time to do that?
Well, you will, but Michael Mara has a question following up on kinship care before you move on to that, Mr. Doris. Is that OK?
Absolutely, yes.
I think incredibly important questions from Mr. Doris. So how much would that cost? Minister?
Claire Hoggie. Convener, as I said earlier on, these are things that we would bring forward in terms of business cases. We're doing the work at this moment to look at all aspects of this, to gather as much data as possible, and we will bring forward business cases for each of the elements that we actually
need to deal with. Mr. Stewart, I think
Ms.
Hoy actually might have an answer to Mr. Mara's question. She had her hand up.
In terms of what's currently happening, because obviously we're talking about a National Care Service which may or may not have children's services in there, so, as I'm sure Mr. Mara is aware, we are in negotiation with COSLA on this very issue and have been for some time, and we are very keen to get a resolution to this. And obviously within that, there would be a financial cost.
This specific area, Ms. Hawkey. So my question essentially was, how many care packages or how many kinship care payments to level up to the higher level? And how much does that cost? And the answer is we don't know.
I don't think that's a question that Mr. Stewart could answer at the moment, but we are not waiting, simply because I don't think he has the figures in front of him. But at the moment, we are working on
this. Could he provide them then to the committee?
I don't have that answer if we could provide that to the committee at this moment. We will see what we can do in terms of providing anything that the committee asks for in that regard.
That's clear. I just want to give Mr. Mara the assurance that we are not waiting for a National Care Service to address this issue.
That's helpful.
Okay, that's helpful.
That's helpful. But if it's possible and someone can provide us with the uplift that would be required to make...
Can I say, Convener, that in terms of that particular issue, we are still in discussion with COSLA around about that, Ms. Colvin has just told me. So we are reliant in some regards in getting this information from COSLA, because we do not hold that information, that data, centrally.
So if perhaps we can get that information,
if we can get that information, we will get it to you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Can we move back to Mr. Doris now? Thank you.
Thanks, Convener. I want to move on to palliative care, but in responding, it would be quite helpful to know just in reference to kinship care, one of the issues, I'll still leave this hanging, then I'll go to my substantive question, is that commissioning of complex services for trauma-informed care for young people in kinship environments that are quite often very vulnerable can see special facilities. I was one of my constituency, Minister, looking for money from the Integrated Joint Board, from a local authority, from NHS Direct, from a number of local authorities, and there's a bit of uncertainty around long-term funding in those situations for what are specialist facilities. I'm hoping the National Care Service may be able to improve that kind of situation, but that's not a substantive question, but I did want to put that on the record. So I chair the cross-party group in palliative care in the Scottish Parliament, and I have to say the engagement with government has been fantastic, and I know that palliative and end-of-life care will form part of a new National Care Service. Also know there's a new National Palliative Care Strategy pending, but there are, I check, there are 16,700 children based on 2020 figures who would benefit, babies, children and young people who would benefit from palliative and end-of-life care because of life-shortening conditions. Three die every single week, tragically. There's good support out there, but it's sometimes inconsistent, that support. I know there's been good investment in the Children's Hospice Network, but there's a feeling that integrated joint boards and others perhaps still do not have a coherent strategy across the country to give meaningful palliative care access to babies, children and young people. Is there anything either ministers can say in relation to how you work with the sector to make that happen and make sure that the National Care Board drives forward improvements in that area?
So part of the drive for the National Care Service is to have that consistency right across the country, so there would be access to the care that was needed when it was needed, regardless of the part of the country that you lived in. In terms of the specific commissioning for those services that you're talking about, that would currently be commissioned by IJBs or local authorities or health boards, that commissioning would be done by the National Care Service. I don't know if Iona's got a little bit that she wants to add there.
That commissioning would be done by local care boards, but let me expand on that. Because there, in all of this, there's the opportunity for a Once for Scotland approach for specialised services. You know, one of the key aspects, key elements of the bill is ethical commissioning and getting this right. Now, I said that commissioning would be done by local care boards, but we are also very well aware that for some specialisms, some very complex cases, there is real difficulty at this moment in getting it right for folks. So that's why the bill in itself also includes the ability to set up special care boards, and that those may be set up to deal with those Once for Scotland elements where there is more complexity. Is the committee could well imagine at crossing our desks on a regular basis are some pretty complex cases that health and social care partnerships, local authorities, health boards have a great difficulty in commissioning the right service for that individual because of the complexity of their needs. We have the ability here, I think, to make some real differences here and take a national approach to some of that as well as, you know, allowing the flexibility at a local level.
Okay.
Is that you?
For the moment.
Oh, for the moment, that's great. Thank you. Can we move to questions now from Ruth McGuire, please?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Ministers. I'd like to direct my questions to the Minister for Children and Young People. Please, Convener. The committee met in private with organisations that work with and represent children and young people, including care experienced children and young people, those affected by domestic abuse, children and young people in conflict with the law, neurodivergent children and young people, and young carers. Just to reflect on the situation at the moment in children's services, I suppose, and I think we'd all recognise there is good work ongoing, but some of the feedback that we got from them were that families were being bounced around the system. A rights-focused approach hasn't been adopted across the system. They spoke to us about organisational gatekeeping and that children, young people and families often have to prove extreme need to access services. They said there was no shared language between organisations on occasion, and the responsibility shifted from organisation to organisation. Now, we've had integration for over 10 years. So my question is, what about having a national care service, including children's services, will make these experiences better for children and families, and how will we ensure that, that rights-based approach?
I think that's a very fair and reasonable question. I think there's probably every MSP sitting around this table would have experienced constituency cases where families or children are approaching us with similar difficulties and concerns and worries. And certainly those are issues that were raised during the consultation and during the events that Mr. Stewart has been holding and in his conversations with children and young people. So I absolutely recognise those concerns. And the integration, while it has worked well in some areas and does provide some excellent services, and I don't want this to sound like I'm criticising the staff working within those services, because there are, you know, they've gone above and beyond, particularly over the last couple of years. But I think that is evidence of why we need that national consistency, why we need those minimum standards, why we need a charter for people's rights that they're able to claim, and why we need those voices at the table when we're co-designing services, so that there aren't the boundaries to accessing services, so there is that consistency, so you can move from one local authority area to another and expect the same level of service. So I think the experiences that those children and young people have experienced are not uncommon, are a driving force behind the independent review into adult social care, but also lend a voice to perhaps why children's services should also be included.
Another thing that was raised, I mean, and the Minister previously talked about implementation gaps, and obviously we know that we have lots of good policy and law, but sometimes the experience for our citizens doesn't reflect the good intentions there. We can't ignore the resource aspect of that. So I guess, you know, what is it about the national service that will help with that resource aspect of the implementation gap?
If I can maybe come in, convener, because Ms. Maguire is absolutely right to concentrate on implementation gaps. And, you know, obviously the committee has talked to a number and listened to, more importantly, a number of young people. You know, in some regards, what we see in terms of resource is far too much resource being put in at crisis point and not enough in terms of prevention. And what you will find is, you know, those areas that concentrate in a more preventative way, where the linked up services are there, they spend much less on crisis. And I think we need to recognise that much of the system, not just in children's services but in adult services, is focused on crisis spend at this moment, which costs a lot of money. And there's also the human cost of not getting those preventative services right. I think that Ms. Hawkey is absolutely right in terms of the opportunity that we have in terms of, and again, whether in or children's services are in and out, because of the work that we're doing at this moment, we can look at where things are not working and look to see what we can do to improve. Now, that would be easier in some regards in terms of national standards within NCS, but that doesn't mean to say that we should not be aspiring to bringing up standards right across the board, whether out or in.
Convener, my next question probably won't surprise you. Obviously, I think everyone would subscribe to preventing problems before they happen. The real challenge is moving finance and resource from crisis to prevention. What about the National Care Service will help us do that?
A number of things, convener, in that regard. And again, I will talk about what folks have said to us at this moment. For many people, and let's look at a good example from not so long ago. We talked to and listened to someone who, at the moment, has 15 different interventions in their life from a number of folks in social work and social care. It would be fair to say that person felt that it would be much better if there was a much more joined-up approach rather than the fragmented approach with somebody dealing with each individual element of what is a very complex case. And I'm not going to go into the elements of that complexity because that could identify an individual possibly, and I'm not wanting to do that. So I think that there is the ability, without doubt, in terms of looking at this from the person-centred approach, listening to what folks' needs are, and actually getting this a lot better, rather than us doing certain things to folk that are actually not helping them in any way, shape or form. I don't know if that's helpful to Ms. McGuire or not.
You've got another question, so maybe that might delve a bit deeper.
Iona maybe wants to...
Yep, OK. Ms. Colvin.
Thank you very much. So I think you're hitting on a number of the critical issues, really, I guess. And I'm thinking about what Mr. Rennie said earlier as well. We know that the system just now is not working. The independent care review told us very clearly we've got the promise, which we're all committed to, and it's clear. And the question, I think, children's services that we've been talking around is what's the best way to deliver those services at the point of need? And I think your question's getting to the heart of that in terms of... earlier intervention, which in the long run, and the promise have shown that in the work that they've done, saves money because it saves people coming into crisis. And our aim is to have less children in formal care, more children supported, less children overall supported, hopefully, as families cope and look after their own children. But the system is a long way from that just now. And the decisions around the investment at a local level are taken locally, as you know, because you used to be the treasurer, so you know very well, in terms of the decision-making process. So the prioritisation at a local level is very different. That also relates to Mr. Doris's question around the local allowances, for example, because different councils make different arrangements in terms of what they invest. And as an IGIB chief officer, you spend a lot, you spend most of your year actually negotiating your budget, negotiating with health board on one side, negotiating with the council on the other side. It takes months and months, and then you have to go to all the usual. But basically, that individual negotiation goes on most of the year. There's a couple of months in the middle of the summer where it stops for a wee while. And I think the focus is really... difficult, and quite often that's done on an individual basis. I think one of the very different proposals here for the National Care Service is the funds are allocated directly, and there's a more direct relationship between the fund, what it's spent on, and accountability for that spending and the standards. So I think there's more of a direct relationship, but it's a complex one because it's not about setting that in stone national requirements, but we are doing a lot of co-design work with people around. I think almost in my head it's like a specification. So if we talked about drug services, for example, which have been in the headlines this week, you know, and very important to children because their parents need to get into the rehab services so that they can continue to look after them. There needs to be a minimum an expectation and a standard for what people can expect to get at a local level so that we don't have the postcode lottery. But those services need to flex around local need. So, for example, you know, in some areas you've got island communities, in other areas you've got... So they need to flex. But I do think that this offers the opportunity to bring more standardisation delivered in a flexible way at locality level. And it's a complex relationship, and that also means planning your investment so that you can invest more upstream to prevent and reduce the numbers. I mean, it's costing at the moment, for example, to take one child into severe care, £6,500, one board, local authority this week have paid £6,600 per week for a child. Now, that's where we need to get to, and that's what the promise is about. And I guess the question and the whole point of our research and the consideration is, how do we best deliver that?
Thank you.
Thank you. That's helpful.
Can we move back to questions from Michael Mara, please, on the complexities of
thanks. Thank you, Convener. I mean, this is, I found all those answers very useful, particularly Ms. Colvin's description. I suppose the timing of this is a concern, given that we have a national crisis in social care. Huge issues in terms of staffing of that service, paying for that service, which is causing, and one of the main causes of the disaster that we're seeing ongoing unfolding in our NHS as a result of delayed discharge. Are we not intending at this point in time to drop children's services, the most vulnerable young people, into that maelstrom of a crisis situation? And is there not a risk, and I think I heard this quite clearly from our evidence so far, that people are concerned about the risk of children's services being lost in a care service that has to deal with that crisis? And it's about the children. I'd like to hear from Claire Hawhey first, please.
So children and young people are right at the heart of the co-design of the service, which I think is really important. So ensuring that their voices are there at the table. And we're doing a lot of work with, we have been doing a lot of work with children and young people, a lot of hard to reach voices, disability organisations, children's disability representatives, so that we ensure that their voices are right at the heart of the co-design. And that's important whether those children's services are in the National Care Service or not, and their parents and carers too. So I think it almost runs counter to some of the arguments that I've heard about, well, you shouldn't be looking at children's services currently when you've not made a decision whether or not they should be in the National Care Service. But we actually have to design a National Care Service that will be able to provide that service for children if that decision's made, so that they aren't an afterthought, so we're not doing that retrospectively. So ensuring that their voices are very much at the table. There are difficulties within adult social care services in terms of recruitment and retention. Those are not, and in children's services, those are not unique to Scotland. There are multifaceted reasons for why there have been people who have left our adult social care and children's social care. They've returned home after Brexit. There have been difficulties in recruiting and retaining some of those staff, but we are working to continue to support the social care service so that we do have staffing there. So I can give you some examples of some of the work that we're doing currently across the social care services to support them with recruitment.
The question, okay. Sally, maybe I've not phrased it appropriately. So dropping these young people and their needs into that crisis, and we could talk about the crisis and the causes of it, but I think there are concerns, and we've had that in our evidence so far, that this could almost be precisely the wrong moment to do this, that actually there's a lot of risk that those children get lost in essentially a service that's being designed to deal with acute care issues. So is it not a risk that we could find those children lost in that huge issue that's ongoing at the moment?
So hopefully some of the first part of my answer, or the answer to your question, answered a bit of it, answered some of that, that we're ensuring that children and young people's voices are there in the co-design, so they are there at the table. I don't recognise what Mr Marr is saying about dropping in. This is about providing, potentially, if children's services are in, this is potentially about providing services that give national standards, that give children's rights, that they don't currently have in terms of the charter that's being designed. There is risk either way. There is risk if we don't have children's services within the National Care Service. There will be risks if we do put children's services into the National Care Service. I think we recognise that. So the task for the research that has been commissioned is to come to the best decision about where to place those services for the children that best serve them. So there are going to be changes whether children's services are within a National Care Service or not. So we need to be prepared for those changes. And that's the preparatory work that the government has been doing through our engagement with children and young people and their families, through those organisations that represent them, but also through the research that we've commissioned to look at an evidence base for what is the best way to provide those services.
Can Iona Colvin wants to come in on that point, if that's okay, Michael. Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, I think absolutely that point that we're working with children and families to make sure that they're part of the co-design so that they're not left out. There's also, it's not separate to the discharge of the promise either, so there's work already underway, for example, the redesign of the children's hearing system being led by the promise with children and young people at the heart, and Sheriff Mackey's chairing that. So that's all part of the same thing. It's about how we reshape children's services as we move forward. To come to your point on recruitment and retention, though, which I think you started with, am I right? I think one of the issues at the moment is, because I think you said by dropping children's services and we would make it worse. I think one of the issues on...
What I was saying is that there's evidence that says that there's risk, and it's really about resourcing, I think, the question in terms of the resource and how that's spread.
So I think, just briefly, that the recruitment and retention issue across social work and social care does need a national solution. I think it's gone beyond the local solutions, and I think it's one of the opportunities in the National Social Work Agency, particularly, which I'm leading along with Alison from SASWA and Ben from Social Work Scotland, is looking at how we produce some national approaches to help try and resolve the current issues and difficulties that we have.
OK, I'll maybe come back briefly to that resource then.
Mr Rennie, has a supplementary on that particular theme. Yeah.
The Minister just talked about risk, that we've presented with risk, but isn't it the case that by moving ahead with a national care service, without having thought about where children's services go before you made the decision to proceed with it, has caused the risk? So isn't it the case that the government's caused the risk that you talk about?
I would disagree with that, Mr Rennie. I think what we're doing is we're taking a very measured approach to whether children's services should be included in the National Care Service, looking at the evidence, consulting with stakeholders, consulting with the people who are using those care services at the moment, and helping them to co-design what could be the children's element of a National Care Service.
Back to Mr Marano, please.
Just to finish off on this area, and then I've one more about resourcing, if that's OK, Convener. I mean, would the government be minded to amend Schedule 3 of the Act to narrow the scope of the powers in the bill relating to these issues, to give some clarity in terms of what is in and what is out around children's services? I understand the arguments around co-design in terms of the process, but it feels to me we're in a kind of a back to managing that risk and where these lines drop between services, and the Minister talked eloquently about the gap between different areas, that actually perhaps you could reflect on that and see whether that might be a possibility. But more broadly on the issues of resourcing, you've talked in your evidence today about national collective bargaining, essentially around social work services. You've talked about Once for Scotland commissioning of services in this area. You've talked about a variety of areas, about the kinship care areas, about making sure that we level up the amount of money that's involved against it. I've not heard any analysis of the resourcing that might be against any of these areas.
Convener, if I could start off in terms of national collective bargaining, which Mr Mara talked about. I think over many years, the social work, social care profession has had difficulties in terms of pay and conditions in social care because of the disparate amount of employers, 1,200 in Scotland, and in social work there's been some competition even between local authorities in terms of trying to attract folks. And beyond that, while pay and conditions are extremely important, and pay is way up there, without a doubt, in talking to younger folk and listening to younger folk in social work and social care, one of the things that they want to see is a greater ladder there for career progression, which they don't think is there at this moment, which I think, again, is something that we can build on in the National Care Service. In terms of the resourcing, in all of this, without a doubt, there is a job of work to do in terms of looking at what the co-design comes up with and what the costing of that is. Now, we're not I'm not coming here, as I've said earlier, in terms of talking annual budgets. That's a matter for Parliament. But what we will do as we move forward with a co-design and with all elements of this is come up with the cost and the benefits, because there may well be benefits rather than just costs to some of the things which are being proposed here or will be proposed during the co-design phase. And that work will be ongoing. And as I've said to this committee and to others, to Parliament as a whole, you know, we will come back with that analysis, with those business cases, around about our intentions in terms of change from those co-design works that we're doing.
I think Ms Haughey wants to come, Michael. Please. Myra, please.
If that's okay, just in particular in reference to your question about Schedule 3 of the bill and the acts that are mentioned there. So all of those acts contain social work-related local authority functions and duties, which is why they're included there. But we will give ongoing consideration to what is in, what is out, based on the evidence and the consultation and the research that's been commissioned. So there is, it's not set in stone. We will give ongoing consideration to those.
We're in listening mode. You know, okay. Co-design is not lip service. We are in listening mode.
Thank you, Mr. And we've got a supplementary on this theme from Bob Doris, please. Just, are you okay?
Yeah, just very briefly, on the kind of funding issues with Mr. Mara, convener, I get the impression that we can't quite decide whether if the National Care Service happens with Children's Services partner, whether there's a big bang launch and it all happens, big shiny new service overnight, or whether there's a strategic evolution of that service over a number of years. So on to kinship care, convener, and costings. Is the expectation that a national kinship care allowance standardised across 32 local care boards would happen in the first instance, or there's a national commitment to that and it will be implemented over a number of years, which will have specific budgetary implications both nationally and locally, which will have to be negotiated with COSLA and the Scottish Government? Because listening to this debate, it's like... Big bang, national case, if it happens, it's all fixed. That's clearly not going to happen. So can you say a little bit more about how resourcing will be allocated going forward so we don't oversell what we're trying to do here and make it a better understanding?
I doubt this is possible, but can we have a really, really concise answer to that question? Because I'm looking at the clock and we've got a number of other themes we need to follow up on. So maybe very concise, Mr. Stewart, please.
It's probably not... possible to give a concise answer, but I'll do the best that I can. As Mr. Doris rightly points out, there is not going to be a massive big bang here. We are going to have to phase all of this over time. And what we are also going to have to do is look at what are the priority elements that should be brought forward first, and what are the costs of those priorities. Now, your priority today has been on kinship carers, and I understand that from my own casework. Other folks' priorities may be on something else in terms of bringing up those standards. We're going to work our way through these. We're going to speak and listen, more importantly, to people. What are the key elements for change first? So, again, that is a key element of the co-design, and I'm quite sure... that people will be setting their priority stalls, and we need to take cognizance of that as we bring all of this.
That was quite concise, convener.
It was very good for Mr. Stewart this morning, yes. Do you want to contribute to anything, Ms. Hawley, or can we move to questions from Mr. Day?
No, I'm happy to move on.
Okay, Mr. Day.
Okay, thank you. I want to put my anorak on, convener, and deal with some of the nuts and bolts around some of this. I'm interested in what work the government is doing or planning to do to determine the exact number and nature of pieces of existing primary legislation that would be engaged by proceeding with the inclusion of children's services. I'm also interested in what work's being done to identify the pathways that would have to be established to interact with those aspects of children's services that are not intended to be captured by proceeding with this. And I guess what flows from that as well is, if you did proceed with the National Care Service for Adults, which is the intention, but then decided not to proceed with children's services, again, new pathways would have to be established. So what work's going on currently or is intended to happen that will identify the scale of the challenge here and the solutions? Because what we would all want to avoid is unintended consequences.
Are you looking for a concise answer to that?
I don't think that's possible, which is why I wanted the last one to be concise, so we could have a bit of time on this topic. So, yeah.
So I think I actually covered some of the primary legislation that Mr. Day alludes to in my answer to Mr. Mara earlier. So the primary legislation is listed in Schedule 3 in the bill. And those are pieces of legislation that all relate to social work-related local authority functions and duties, and we're also in the process of identifying all the work's been carried out to identify all the relevant SSIs which may be affected if those functions were transferred. So there has been a lot of work done already there, and where those adjustments are needed to SSIs to further reflect the transfer of functions, that can be done using the ancillary powers in section 45 of the bill. Hopefully that gives him a bit of a reassurance around about that. I'm afraid he's going to have to repeat part of the second part of his question, and my apologies, Mr. Day, for not scribbling that
down. Okay, so we have the legislative angle to this, but we also have the practical application of it, which is establishing pathways between a National Children's Care Service and how it would interact with existing localised services that weren't captured by the bill. And then if we proceed, as we will, what's intended to proceed, rather, with a National Care Service for Adult Services, and then you make a decision not to proceed with children's services, you need to establish new pathways there to ensure that everything works. So what work's going on in that area?
So Mr. Stewart had already spoken about a phased approach in terms of roll-out of NCS, so it would be similar for children's services, where children's services included within the NCS. We need to maintain strong links right across all of the services that work with children, whether they are within or out with a National Care Service, and I think I touched on that a little bit speaking with answering Mr. Greer about education and early learning and childcare. We need to ensure that those links are built on, are built strongly, but we already have the underpinning, getting it right for every child, that colleagues here will be familiar with, but is everyday working for our health, social care and education staff. It is very well embedded within all of those services and gives a really good strong foundation for how to work across disciplines and across services for the best interests of that child. The work that we're doing currently in terms of the research that CELSIS is carrying out, and also our engagement with children and young people in terms of what they need to see from a National Care Service, what they've asked us, what they tell us is not working well for them, how they would like to services to work better for them, which is essentially what this is about. It's about how it works better for children and families. Will help to inform us going forward, regardless of whether children's services are in the National Care Service or not. I think we would all recognise that improvements have to be made right across children's services. Similarly to adult services, they experience postcode lotteries, they experience difficulties when they are crossing boundaries, local authority boundaries. One local authority may provide service X and the other local authority doesn't. So we will continue an endeavour to work to improve children's services. We already have done a lot of work on that. Iona referenced the promise. There's the whole family wellbeing fund. There's the launch of the new GIRFEC practice guidelines guidance that was launched just a short while ago. So there's been a lot of work done. We're not standing still, regardless of whether children's services are included in NCS or not.
Moving on, convener. Mr. Stewart said that you were in listening mode, and I'm wondering if you're hearing the concerns that are being expressed by MSPs about the role of Parliament
in this being moved forward, if that's what you decide to do. I'm talking specifically about the volume of secondary legislation that would be required to deliver this. It's a substantial volume. And Parliament, I think, is rightly expressing concern about that being the approach. So, do you understand that concern?
Sure. Of course I understand that concern, because Parliament has got a job to do in terms of scrutiny. But what I would say to Mr Day is this framework bill, this enabling bill, it's not unusual. It was the way that the NHS was formed. And I think, you know, I've kind of given an answer to Mr Day earlier around about some of the reasoning for this in terms of the flexibility of being able to make change in secondary legislation, which is not so easy to do in primary legislation. And the SDS example I gave earlier is a very good one, and where Parliament, with the best of intentions, wrote a piece of legislation which, you know, has some flaws in it, which folk have dug into and have stuck to the spirit of that Act. And what we want to do is to create some flexibility so that we can adapt and be flexible as we go along in order to get the service delivery absolutely right.
And there's a logic to that, absolutely.
Yeah.
But what I'd like to hear today is whether the government, in principle at least, is willing to commit to a slightly different approach to this if it's taken forward, one which affords, whether it's this committee or other committees, a greater opportunity to scrutinise what's being proposed. Now, whether that takes the form of, and I'm talking beyond affirmative and super affirmative, is the government willing to commit, in principle at least, to something along the lines of committees taking evidence, almost like a stage one proceeding, producing a report, etc., etc., and treating the secondary legislation perhaps as something resembling a stage two process? Because I think that might give some colleagues a little bit more reassurance about their opportunity to further interrogate this if you decide to take it forward.
So I think there are a number of elements to this which are very, very different, because the co-design aspect is very, very different from what we have ever done before. And of course, you know, it's not just the case of, you know, the scrutiny of us per se, but also, you know, what is the situation in terms of those folks who have helped us shape the decisions to come to the point of the secondary legislation in the first place. Obviously, there will be consultation and all of that as well. This will be somewhat different. Without making any commitments in the here and now, I will reflect on what Mr Day has said here. What I would say, and you know, a number of folk around the table have worked with me before in terms of tricky pieces of legislation, my door is open, and I am willing, you know, to speak to anyone and everyone around about elements of this, whether that be informally or formally. But I will certainly reflect on what Mr Day has said today.
Thank you. Can we move to questions now from CoCab Stewart, please?
Thank you. Thank you, Convener. The research has been referred to a few times, so I'm just going to spend a few minutes digging into that a little bit further. So you've made it clear that no decision has been made, and you've commissioned that research from CELIS. So just sort of very quickly, the background reasons for commissioning it, and what is the timeline for that, and how does that fit with the progress of the bill?
Thanks very much, Mr Stewart, for that question. So I think we sort of touched on this at the very beginning of the committee hearing, when we were talking about why children's services are being considered as part of the National Care Service. The Independent Review of Adult Social Care looked at adult social care, and when the consultation, public consultation on the National Care Service was concluded, it was clear from that, even though we'd asked questions about children's services being included within the NCS, that there were mixed responses to that, mostly on lack of evidence, that people felt there was a lack of evidence behind why you would include NCS, whereas there had already been a large inquiry into adult social care. So as part of an evidence-gathering exercise, we commissioned CELSIS to carry out that independent research. And essentially, the research question was about how do we ensure that children and young people and their families get the help that they need when they need it. And so that's what they have been commissioned to look at. So there's five strands within that research to answer that question. So a rapid evidence review of the published literature, a deep dive to examine the approaches to integration and delivery of children's services, national scoping and mapping exercise to explore the different models of integrated service delivery and any potential effects on a range of outcomes, a national survey of the children's services workforce and children's services leaders to build on emerging findings, and targeted focus groups and interviews with the workforce. So that research, although it won't give us a yes-no answer to that, it will give us an evidence basis on where we are, what is working, and how does the workforce feel. Running it in parallel to that, we're also working with children and young people, their families and organisations representing them and other groups to look at, again at what they feel they need from a national care service. We're not going back to ask them lots of questions that we already have evidence for. We've already got a lot of evidence from the review of the care services. But we will look at all of that evidence in the round to then make a decision on or a decision in principle about whether children's services should or should not be included in the National Care Service. The research will take place over a year. So it started in September 2022. So it will run to next September. The committee may be interested to know that those strands will report as they conclude. And I am more than happy to share those reports with the committee if they would be interested in having that. Obviously, I'm not asking you to make a decision on that today, but the offer is there before they come to their final write-up of the research. And the timeline for the research has been developed so to ensure that we can make those decisions on the inclusion of children's services so they can be taken to run in parallel prior to the operation of the NCS. So that's essentially why the timeline is running as it is.
Yeah, that's quite helpful to get that context because I know that there was a concern that there wasn't enough evidence. It sounds as though the scope of this is quite wide. Are you confident that this research and the method of deployment on this is going to be enough to give you that evidence, and have you got an open mind that if it doesn't provide enough evidence that you're able to gather more?
So we'll look at what the research tells us. Mm. We'll also look at what the stakeholders and what the people involved in the service tell us. So that it's not we're not looking at things in isolation. I think that's really important. We've spoken, and Mr. Stewart's spoken about co-design, and so it's vitally important that we listen to those who use care services and hear their opinions on what the service for children should look like. As I said in my response, I think to Mr. Day or it might be Mr. Maguire, apologies this evidence gathering, this consultation will not go to waste children's services are not included in NCS. What it will do is help us to drive forward change that is needed, but change that is wanted and change that will actually suit the needs of children and their families best.
Thank you for that. That actually very neatly leads me on to some questions to possibly Mr. Stewart. We have, quite rightly, you've pointed out, two sessions already on this committee where we heard from a variety of stakeholders and service providers. Can you provide any evidence during your consultation processes from advocacy groups or give some examples of the lived experience that you heard where possibly the services haven't been as good as they could have been for certain young people?
Convener, we could provide many, many examples of where services have not delivered very well for people. I would harken back to what I said earlier. Some of the areas where there are real difficulties for folks are in transition stages from children's to adult services. Often, you know, and you probably have all had it in your mailbags and your inboxes around about some young person leaving school and then left with nothing in terms of care and support, which obviously has a major impact on somebody with a disability or a learning disability. So there are lots and lots of examples of where, you know, that transition has not worked. We could probably provide the committee with some very good examples. I'm always a bit feared to give examples because some of the examples I've got, you could end up with a situation where you could identify the individual because some of it is so complicated.
Yeah, I do understand that and respect that. I just think it would be very useful for the committee to hear from the perspective of the young person with their voice and that real life example. It sort of gives a good illustration of their experience of the service. So that's why I was keen to.
We can provide you with many examples, I'm quite sure, in terms of the evidence we've gathered. I don't know if Iona's got any. Colvin's got any to hand at the moment.
I mean, it's a major strand of the work, and the promise clearly is, it's very clear the voice is there. And we've been working with Who Cares Scotland and the disability, forgot what they're called, Paul, the Committee for Children and Young People with Disability, who are the two main groups that we're engaged with in terms of engagement and thinking about co-design. So I think that variation in experience is very real in children's services. And there's lots of really good, there are really good examples of good practice. The problem is it's not consistent and it's not evenly spread across Scotland. And that is the basic problem here. If the system was operating to the highest level of the best partnerships, then we probably wouldn't be sitting in this room talking about it.
Yeah.
But the reality is that it's not.
Yeah, I suppose from my point of view, I'm looking, you know, we've got the evidence from the service providers and stakeholders and the services they provide, and I want to be able to cross-check that with the real experience of the recipients of those services, I think. And that was the areas I was exploring. I mean, I'm happy for Mr. Stewart to come back.
I'll come back very briefly. I mean, in some regards, one of the simple things to look at, let's go back to self-directed support. In some parts of Scotland, children and young people are not being able to access self-directed support. You know, as simple as that. And if you talk to some of the stakeholders, many of them will point out that in terms of joining up services for young people with similar care needs, that can be very different from one area to the next. And, you know, top quality service in one area, making sure that the linkages are all there. And, you know, next and nothing in the next.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, convener.
I suppose we've heard a lot about a phased approach and we've not really been given a time scale as to how long this may take for that big new organisation to be embedded. Because we'd heard in the past from Mike Burns from Social Work Scotland that suggests culture change takes 5, 10 or 15 years. And you mentioned earlier on, Mr. Stewart, that legislation and regulation does not bring about that change in culture. So, and I'm given that it was taking so long for the integration legislation to get to this point, which still has problems, do you think that all these years of change and adjustment is worth it? And should we not be focusing here and now on what we can improve on now?
I think that we need to improve on the here and now as well. And that is what we will continue to do as a government across services. Even in these tough financial times. But what we actually require is a service that is fit for the future. And a service which is built with people at its very heart. At this moment, we have a huge amount of folks out there who receive care and support in order to survive. And what we actually need to do is turn that around so that folks can thrive. That is the ambition of this. Person-centred, human rights at its heart, closing those implementation gaps by actually getting those folks who are in, receiving services at this moment, but also those folks who are at the front line helping us shape it. And I think we have got a huge opportunity here in terms of changing culture, because what we are finding at this moment in many parts of the country is where frontline staff have more autonomy and independence, that means better delivery for people. And if the committee were minded to go out and about and speak to frontline staff in certain places, you will find without doubt that freedom and autonomy to the front line, which has been restricted and clawed back in many places over the piece, is the right way forward. And I think we, in so doing, will improve services for people right across the board.
Thank you, Mr. Stewart. We have had some informal sessions with the service deliveries, albeit from the voluntary sector, so we're aware of that. Can I go to a final question from Mr. Willie Rennie, please?
Mr. Stewart, you'll have seen Darren Fitzhenry's contribution to the Health Committee yesterday, where he's expressed concerns that would potentially give ministers sweeping powers to limit the scope of his investigations into social care complaints. What's your response to that?
Ministers will not impose on any of these. What we are going to build here is a system which allows folk the opportunity to get redress, the right redress for their complaints. We are talking about improving the complaint system, and certainly I do not see that as being it's not how I would describe things anyway. We want to get absolutely right complaints and redress. That is a major, major thing for the public at large, and that is one of the areas which we are absolutely adamant we'll get right.
Thank you, Mr. Stewart. Thank you all for your time today, and the public part of our meeting is now at an end. We will consider our final agenda items in private. Thank you very much. Thank you, panel.